Hello, fans of Dream of Darkness. I'm Javier, game director, and I'm here with our historian, Mario. Now, Mario is an expert in all things Mexica, or Aztecs, as commonly called in English, but he's a specialist in weapons, and today we have a few minutes with him. Our community has asked us a few things about what happens with this amazing civilization, so we can ask them for you, our dearest community. Now, Mario, what can you tell us first about your work? What is your day-to-day life? What are you specialized in?
Yo soy especializado en el siglo XVI.
I am specialized in the 16th century.
Particularmente en el armamento español.
Particularly in Spanish weaponry.
Pero además he tenido que abordar el periodo anterior.
Besides, I have also considered and studied the previous period.
Y por lógica, el periodo de la conquista.
And thus, the period of the conquest.
Eso es lo que yo me especializo.
That's what I'm specialized in. Perfect. Now, you've told us what you're specialized in, and that gives a lot of range in order to study wars, what actually happened, because you have to study the evidence, correct? Mm-hmm. There are a lot of myths surrounding how the Mexica, the Aztecs, and the Spanish battled. What is the number one myth that you usually hear about the Spanish, about the Aztecs, their weaponry, their kind of war? What can you tell us?
Primer mito.
First
mito
myth,
más grande.
The biggest myth.
Yo creo que sería pensar que eran dos bandos contrariamente opuestos.
The first myth is that they were two opposite groups. Mm-hmm.
En realidad eran un mosaico de diferentes alianzas y enemigos.
Actually, they were a mosaic of different allies and enemies.
Que al final convergieron para tener el desenlace que tuvimos.
That in the end they converged, so we had the result that we live.
Entonces, eso es lo que creo que es el primer mito, ¿no?
That's the first myth, that there were two distinct unified groups, which they weren't. Mm-hmm. Why do you say they weren't two distinct groups? What kind of differences there were between, for example, the Spanish group? Were they really more than one group within?
Por ejemplo, si consideramos los españoles,
for example, if we consider the Spanish,
entre ellos había diferentes facciones también.
Even among them, there were different factions inside the Spanish.
Recordemos que el gobernador de Cuba manda a gente a apresar a Cortés. Porque
let's remember that the governor of Cuba, he wanted to have a Cortés prisoner.
Porque desobedeció las órdenes del gobernador.
Because he defied the governor's orders.
Y además, Cortés no peleó solo. Él tuvo miles de aliados indígenas.
Besides, Cortés did not fight alone. He had thousands of native allies.
Que lo alimentaban, lo hospedaban.
Who fed him, gave him a roof.
Le decían dónde ir porque obviamente ellos no sabían los caminos.
Told him where to go because he didn't know the way.
Le cargaban las cosas, en fin.
Even carried his gear.
Le proporcionaban la logística.
Yeah, they gave him the logistics in order to accomplish his goal.
Inclusive, algunos grupos indígenas conquistaron zonas para la corona española sin que participara un solo español.
Even some Native Americans conquered parts of the territory without any Spanish participating, and that was in the name of the crown.
Entonces eso pone en evidencia lo complejo, ¿no?, del periodo.
Yeah, this puts in evidence the complexity of this period. Let's go into another topic. One of our community members asked, Perades from Iceland, can you imagine? He asked, what can you tell us about the underworld? Mm-hmm. The underworld is distinct in the Aztec mythology, in the Mexica mythology. What can you tell us about the differences? What makes it special?
es muy difícil saberlo.
It's very hard to know.
Porque todo lo que sabemos sobre la mitología mexica o azteca,
because everything we know about the Mexica or Aztec mythology,
lo sabemos por los documentos coloniales.
We know thanks to the colonial documents.
Entonces, en estos documentos coloniales ya está una visión cristiana del mundo.
Thus, in these colonial documents, there's already a Christian point of view of the world.
Estos documentos nos hablan más del mundo europeo medieval que del mundo mexica.
These documents tell us more about a Christian point of view than the actual Mexica viewpoint.
Se supone que hay una jerarquía del inframundo.
Supposedly there's a hierarchy in the underworld.
Pero se parece muchísimo a la que está en el infierno de Dante.
Yeah, but it looks a lot like Dante's hierarchy. Very suspicious.
Sospechosamente, muy sospechosamente.
Yeah, I can imagine.
El inframundo mexica, descrito por los documentos coloniales,
the underworld of the Mexicas described by the colonial documents,
se parece también mucho al limbo cristiano.
It's very similar to the Christian limbo.
Porque en la mentalidad cristiana, los mexicas tenían que ir al limbo al morir.
Because in the Christian viewpoint, the Mexicas had to go to the limbo when they died.
Entonces es muy difícil saber qué pensaban los mexicas del más allá a partir de estos documentos. Es muy difícil saberlo.
Therefore, it's very difficult to know what the Mexicas actually thought based on these documents. So our audience knows this colonial period, more or less, how many years are between the siege of Tenochtitlan and the actual writing of these documents?
Depende qué documento. Pero las cartas de relación se hicieron en ese momento.
Okay, it depends on the document. At least the relation letters were written in that period when the siege of Tenochtitlan happened, around 1521.
Otros documentos, como el Códice Florentino, de donde sabemos mucha de esta información.
Other documents, like the Códice Florentino,
tuvieron varias décadas. Pasaron varias décadas después del sitio de Tenochtitlan.
There were many decades between the actual writing and the siege of Tenochtitlan. Mm-hmm. So it had an impact, obviously, if there were decades between the fall of a civilization and the actual writing of what they believed, right?
Sí, por supuesto, ya había los famosos informantes que ayudan a escribir estos documentos. Eran indígenas, pero totalmente cristianizados.
Yes, of course there was a difference, because the natives who reported on what was believed, they were natives who were already Christians, so their beliefs had already changed.
Totalmente. De hecho, eran indígenas eruditos que hablaban náhuatl, español y latín.
There were indigenous people who spoke three languages, náhuatl, Spanish and Latin.
Entonces, estas personas estaban totalmente en el universo mental europeo, más que otras personas.
So these people were already in the European universe, more than any other person in the continent.
Hay varios estudios que te pueden permitir ver cómo los mitos europeos medievales son trasladados a los mitos prehispánicos.
There are lots of studies that tell us how these European viewpoints were transported to these native accounts, these supposedly native accounts.
Al grado que una leyenda indígena o que se hace pasar por indígena tiene su contraparte en una leyenda europea.
Wow, even supposedly native legends actually had a counterpart in legends from other parts of the world. Wow.
O sea que de indígenas prehispánicos no tienen nada.
Yeah. So actually, Native American legends, they were not. Okay. Muy interesante. Aquí vamos a ponerle una pausa rápidamente. ¿Crees, man, que le puedes marcar?